that up for a little bit, Carl. It may be a little bit unclear, in my opinion, right, in terms of it separates, if the tubing separates from the apparatus, well, then we have to, we have the cylinder here. Right, we have a regulator. And then 15 feet of tubing. So this would have to be our apparatus, right? So we can assume that this regulator here sits right on the tank. There's not much to it. And then, so we have 15 feet here. And this is a 250 PSI gauge, which is 264.7 PSI absolute. Okay, so if this had been, if this breaks off here, right, then we can calculate what the choke pressure is. We can't do that here because that's choke pressure coming out of here is not the same as the choke pressure coming out of here. Okay, so we're just going to have to assume certain conditions and then go back and check. So basically what we're assuming is, assume adiabatic flow. So what we're trying to solve is this one, 1, 2, and we should write out 2 times 1 plus 7 times 1 equals 2 squared. So what was the first thing I said, fanning friction factor? Copper tubing, and if I'm not mistaken, drawn copper tubing, no, so there are actually, I don't have the table here, there are actually two values for their tube, at least two. Okay, so what do we assume for maximum flow?
One,
so
CO is one.
So what do we need? If we have two values for epsilon, one is, let's say, 0.00008, and the other one is, say, 0.004, which one do we choose? Which worst case scenario, right? We wanna if it's not stated, we wanna choose worst case scenario. Worst case scenario would be a smooth pipe. Right? Okay, so epsilon assume mu for worst case. Tubing would be 0.00008 inches. So do we have all the information we had from here?
We may need our T, right, which is 75 degrees Fahrenheit. This would be our T1.
Okay. We don't know. Out of here, we have T2, which we don't know. Another thing to make a note of, right, the order of magnitude of your F, it's right for different conditions, new, it's usually around there, right? So if you get an F of 37, then you probably have some unit mistake somewhere, right? Okay, so what do we have? Okay, so what we have, like, we need the heat capacity for ratio for nitrogen, which is given 1.41, that's in table 4-3, and our epsilon was from table 4-1, which I'm sure you know by now. Okay, let's see if I can get this right this time. So 75 degrees Fahrenheit is 297.04 Kelvin. Into this equation, right? Put all the known variables in there. So we have gamma plus 1 is 1.41 plus 1 over 2 times ln 2 plus 0.205. Okay, that we have to solve for Mach 1. Okay, so obviously you can graph that if you want. Or you can start guessing, right? Because what do we know about Mach numbers?
It's
less than 1, greater than 0. Right, so we can always, right,
Okay, you can always guess if you want. If we put a Mach 1 equals 0.2 in there, for example, then our left-hand side is equal to minus 4.174. If we put a Mach 1 of 0.3, the left-hand side is equal to 7.91. All right, if we keep doing this, or if we solve it, we get a Mach of about 225. Okay, so our QM, right, is then we need to calculate our flux and multiply it by the area. And this is equal to area times Mach 1 P1. And we have gamma GC equal to the weight over RT1. So, in this case, if it separates from the apparatus, we're just going to assume that we're exposed, say the hole is basically the entire diameter of the pipe.
Okay, so if we can convert that from pi squared 6.35, so that's quarter inch meters. Obviously, I prefer SI units. So, our QM equals area times our G. So, it's 3.67 minus 5 times G, which is down there, with our Mach number 225. And then we have pressure 2.5×10⁶. This is Newton per square meter. And this is times this whole square root, 1.41 times 0.0. This is kilogram meter second square root. And 28 molecular weight. Nitrogen, kilograms per mole, 8.314 per mole Kelvin, and it was 297 Kelvin. And square root of that. Okay, we're going to have kilogram squared, meters per moles, Kelvin, Kelson, cancel out. And that gives us a QM of 0.0519. That is in kilograms per second, or if you want 52 grams per second. So we weren't asked for this. So this is the typical case, okay? But let's just see how this changes
if we instead assume isothermal flow, okay, because then, right, what we're looking for, right, is worst case scenario, right? So in other words, is it worse to assume isothermal flow versus adiabatic? Because what if we're closer to isothermal, even though, right, for whatever reason?
It's strong copper tubing after all. Okay, so this is not actually, I'm going to put that on here. This is not part of the problem, okay? But I think it's important to look at both conditions. So in this case, we're going to assume isothermal conditions, but still choke the flows. Okay, so how does this change? Well, T1 is now equal to T2, and instead of the other equation we had, we get to solve this one. Simpler, but it's still not a function that you can easily solve for a Mach number. So 4-1 squared minus 1/4-1 squared, and let me see. So there is a difference, right? The other equation had a gamma in front of here. So this here is now 11.867. And the whole thing is equal to 0. So if we solve this one, so obviously since we already know, if we guess, say, the same Mach number we had last time, would close our left-hand side is equal to -0.102. If we continue, it's probably there. So it's close to the other Mach number that we had. Okay. So our QM